was born in a little town called Vallejo, California, 30 miles away from San Francisco. And I grew up in a home. My father was a pastor of a Pentecostal church, and my mother was a musician, and we had brothers and sisters, and music was in the family. My cousin Sly Stone and Sly the Family Stone, we literally lived around the corner from each other, and so music was just a great influence, and that's really all we knew, church and music.
I'm gonna find rest beyond the river.
My relationship with the late Bishop G.E. Patterson started in the 90s. I was a musician for him, and I had the opportunity to do some traveling with him. He was a great preacher. I think he was a great orator of the gospel. The tribute project to Bishop G.E. Patterson, which was co-produced with myself and Edwin Hawkins, I think it's one of the greatest works we've ever done together, with Rance Allen, Beverly Crawford, Dottie Peoples, his brother, the late Walter Hawkins, and Marvin Winans, I Feel Like Going Home, and just other songs. My daughter's on there, Tiffany, I Am Redeemed, and Bishop Stevens, Reverend Frank Ray move upstairs. I mean, it just, it goes on. Bishop Daryl Hines, Willie James Campbell, the late Timothy Wright. I mean, part one, then there's part two that haven't been released yet. But the record has done so well, and it's such a strong record. I think it'll be selling when we all dead, because the songs are cultural. It's songs that I believe Bishop G.E. Patterson would have really appreciated, because it's traditional music, and he was a traditional gentleman, and it moves people, and I think it's something special about the project that it probably would never be one like that that I'll be involved in that had that many elements with that much passion with them types of songs. The songs, I believe, touch the core of gospel music and gospel music lovers, and I believe it's going to go on and on and on and on. I really do. Edwin Hawkins, Walter Hawkins, and the Hawkins family, that relationship goes back many years. I grew up in Vallejo, California. They was in Oakland, which is only 18 miles away physically. And Oh Happy Day, of course, I was only 9 years old, I think, when that came out. And now I'm finna release the new Oh Happy Day with Edwin Hawkins himself leading it on the Jubilee Project next year. And the Hawkins, when I took over the gospel at Bellmark Records, Edwin Hawkins was the first one I reached out to, and Walter, and they all rallied around the vision at the time. And every project from the Church of God in Christ to mine, to the family, whenever I called the Hawkins, they were there. Money was never an issue, it's never been an issue. They just believed in the vision, and they gave me the most support. They continue to do so. I can never thank the Hawkins enough. I don't think they've ever really received the total credit that they've really been due. Their contribution to gospel music transcends the United States of America. I mean, you go all over the world. When I was in Japan, Oh Happy Day is there. We went to Amsterdam, is there. Germany is there. Went to Australia with Billy Preston, is there. I mean, Oh Happy Day is everywhere. And to be with Edwin Hawkins and to be getting ready to hit the road with him again with the new Oh Happy Day, I mean, I just can't, you know, say enough. Losing Walter, even though we didn't lose him, we know where he is. It's a big loss. He was so gifted. To be in the studio with him, I mean, I'm sitting in the studio with these guys, and they're geniuses. But they treat me like I was really, you know, an equal. And I knew better, and I know better. We'll be right back. I would say my key musical influence growing up had to be, first of all, my cousin Sly Stone. After him, it would be Billy Preston. And then gospel, of course, it would be Edward Hawkins, Walter Hawkins, Twinkie Clark, all of whom I've had the privilege of working with, producing gospel music with. In fact, my first record I got to play on when I was 12 years old was Sly Stone's record, a song called I Get High on You, that somebody just posted on YouTube all of a sudden. And my father being a Pentecostal pastor, they thought that that kind of music you wasn't supposed to play, rock and roll, some thought it was, and R&B or whatever, urban music. And but my father allowed me to play on that record when I was 12 years old, and Sly made me feel like I was just a great organist. And I'm just this little kid going to the studio, and I'm thinking, you know, this is Sly Stone, big Rolls Royces and things all outside. And I go in there and I play the organ, and everybody's in the studio, and Sly's telling everybody, can't nobody play like my little cousin, little Moses. And I'm like, what is this? But from that, I met a man named Roy Siegel. And many years later, I would go on. It's amazing how God does things. I would go on later, when I got older and decided I wanted to get in the record business, the gentleman that was the engineer and the co-producer of the record that I did with my cousin, Sly Stone, he produced a demo on me. And from that demo, I got my first record contract with EMI Music Capital. And it was an urban contract. My father was a Pentecostal pastor and I was a youth leader. And when I signed the contract, he got up in the pulpit and took me down as a youth leader. So I guess it was just meant to be this way because, in other words, they did not want me to have any success in urban music. And God answered their prayers because I didn't have any. Dr. Maddie Moss Clark, the mother of the Clark sisters and the former International Church of God in Christ music president, had such a great influence on me. I met her when I was 13 years old. Her and